And thank you for all joining us this evening for, on behalf of the League of Women Voters New Hampshire, the Greater Nashua Chapter. We really thank you for coming this evening and being engaged with our forums. We thank all of our candidates for joining us this evening. My name is Kim Kleiner. I am co-chair, along with Gwen Michaela, of the Nashua Chapter of the League of Women Voters. We are a nonpartisan organization devoted to voter education and advocacy. And part of our mission is to encourage the informed and active participation of citizens in government. We would like to thank this evening for the Nashua Public Library for hosting us and for sponsoring us, along with the Telegraph. Our local league has been very active for the past 3 years now. We have meetings every Tuesday, the second Tuesday of the month, here at the library at 7 p.m. And we welcome anyone who would like to join us. We have had forums for the past two elections now, as well as what we call our local observer corps. Members of the league that go out and participate watching local government meetings. You may have seen some articles written in the Telegraph of members that have written up brief stories, and that's part of our education initiative. We'd also like to encourage you to join us for some of our other forums that are coming up. And if you saw our table out at the entrance, you would have seen we have a candidate forums guide. We have a voters guide, as well as all the dates of our upcoming forums from now until just a couple days before the election. We would really like to thank our student members who have joined us tonight. Cassidy, who did the Pledge of Allegiance, Ben Tolerski, and Dara Fupala. We really encourage our local students to become actively involved. They've helped us with other forums last year when we were at Nashua High School South, and we like to see the young engaged in our initiatives and get involved in what's happening in their city as well. Tonight, we are very honored to have Liz Tentramelli from the State League here to moderate. She is president of the League of Women Voters in New Hampshire. And thank you, Liz, for being here.
Thank you. Kim said it so well, that our mission is really to create an informed voting public, to encourage voting. But we also want to thank the candidates for running for office. Without them, democracy would not be possible. And we thank you for coming. Now let's do a little bit of housekeeping. Please turn off your cell phones or put them on vibrate. And if you need to take a call, because it's an emergency call, please step outside. We're very proud of the work that the League of Women Voters in Greater Nashua has done just in the last few years since they've been reorganized. So you've got some materials, so you've got some background on the candidates. We have asked you to write out questions if you wish. We have some questions already prepared, and the candidates are going to answer them. We're going to have fun. You'll get to know the candidates, they'll get to know your concerns. By the luck of the draw, we have a sequence that we'll use for the opening remarks and the closing remarks, and during the evening the questions will rotate. So let me explain how our timing will work. Candidates will have 2 minutes for their opening statements. At 1.5 minutes, my friend Kate will hold up the 30-second warning. And then at 2 minutes, she will hold up the stop sign. So try to finish your sentence, and then we'll move on to the next speaker. When we are trying to answer questions in general, they will each be about a minute and a half. If I sense that you're in the middle of a complicated explanation, I may allow you to go over time. So don't panic just because Kate's waving that sign at you. But it will keep us a little bit organized, and then we'll have 1 minute for the closing statements. I'm going to ask the audience to refrain from applause because it'll give us more time for questions. So, with that in mind, we have determined who our first speaker is, and that is Mr. LeBrun. Please.
Thank you. My name is Don LeBrun. I represent Ward 5, which is from Exit 5 west to Ward Hollis. I'm currently a state representative and an alderman. I've been in Nashua now for 18 years. I came here in 2000. I've served at the State House since 2010. I currently serve on 22 different committees, all health related. That's my main interest, is health care and the welfare of children. My motivation in politics is simply to serve the residents to the best of my ability. If someone calls me or if someone emails me or contacts me in any way, they can send a carrier pigeon. My information is all out there. I get back to them. I try to resolve the problem as quickly as possible. I've been very fortunate in getting problems solved. I've gotten many a pothole fixed. I've gotten roads paved. I've gotten signage installed. I've gotten speed limits changed. But as I said, my main interest is in the welfare of children. I serve on child hunger. I serve on child abuse fatalities, suicide prevention, committees like that. I'm also the chairman of the Hillsborough County delegation. I say it. which is something that goes along with being a state representative. It's also your duty to serve the county. So at this time, we have a 122-member county delegation, and I am currently the chair of that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. LeBrun. Ms. Boris.
Good evening. Good evening. My name is Evstathia Boris. I'm running for alderman of Ward 6 because I'm passionate about representing my constituents and creating a city of Nashua where no voice is neglected. My family and I have lived in Nashua for 30 years. My children were born and raised in Nashua, and I own and operate a business downtown for the past 20 years, Alpha Mortgage and Financial Services, where I make dreams of homeownership a reality for many. I've served in the New Hampshire House of Representatives for two terms, being your voice in Concord, 2012 to 2016. I served on the Executive Department and Administrative Committee, along with the State Federal Relations and Veterans Affairs Committee. I was honored with the first Humane Legislator of the Year Award in 2016 from the Humane Society of the United States, of which I sponsored several bills in animal cruelty, which I'm a voice for the voiceless. As your alderman of Ward 6, I will be a voice in City Hall, supporting my ward, being accessible, and responding to your concerns. I will work to assure that Nashua continues to move forward, and I strongly support our education system and our teachers, our public safety, our police officers, firefighters, and emergency responders. I support affordable housing and revitalizing our downtown in providing culture, entertainment, opportunity for its residents, and to support and attract our downtown business. I support a fiscal budget that adequately meets the needs of our city and citizens without eliminating essential services.
Thank you, Ms. Boris. Also from Ward 6, Mr. Gidge.
Hi, I'm Ken Gidge. I'm from Ward 6. I have lived in Ward 6 my whole life so far. In Ward 6, there's St. Joe's Hospital. That's where my father and his brothers and sister were born. They lived on Blossom Street. My great passion has always been, because I grew up in the family, has been sort of creative, inventing. I've gone to Boston and studied at the Art Institute. I've gone to acting school. I've come back and I've had inventions marketed nationally and internationally. And I've done radio, I've done TV. But I was asked to get into politics. And when I got up to Concord, I wanted to be in commerce. That's banking, insurance, and consumer affairs. Imagine getting up there when all the banking problems were taking place as a new state legislator. Now, what is taking place? All to do with insurance. I know this ward very well. I know a lot of people. I am the chair studying the economic impacts of the arts and culture in the state of New Hampshire. Wrote the bill with Representative Rice. We have a lot of important information to give everyone. The Telegraph is so good to give me space. I give them the story, so you've got to get a lot of information. One thing, my candidate sitting right beside me was up in Concord, and I can only tell you that if we had just a little more help, she would still be up there. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Gidge. And Mr. Lopez, Ward 4.
Thank you. Hope everybody can hear me. My name is Tom Lopez. I'm the current alderman of Ward 4, and I'm seeking re-election. I just want to start by apologizing because the work that's being done by the League and the time everyone is spending tonight is very important. It's very important to speak to your representatives, your candidates. It's important in terms of democracy to be able to get to know the people who are running for office. But I have another commitment this evening because I have to be at the Infrastructure Committee. And I had to make a choice between performing the duties for which I was elected and trying to run for re-election. So it's kind of a conundrum. So I will have to duck out very shortly. But I wanted to introduce myself, and I want to invite everybody in the audience. If you have questions that you want to hear my answer to, feel free to reach out. My information is on the city's website. I've been referred to as ubiquitous on Facebook. So there's many ways to get a hold of me. If you see me out in the neighborhoods, just pull me over and talk to me, and I'd be happy to answer any questions. Myself, I'm the shelter manager at Maple Arms Shelter. We have a veterans housing program, a transitional housing program, the emergency shelter, and the safe stations program. I'm a founding member of Positive Street Art. I believe in inspiring a passion for urban arts and in harnessing the creativity and energy of the community in a positive and productive way. As alderman, my priorities have been to do what is best for Ward 4. It's the heart of Nashua, in my mind, and literally speaking. It's the hub of all transportation. It's where all of the cultural diversity is located. It's where people come to see how well Nashua is doing economically. We faced a lot of challenges over the last 2 years with a lack of affordable housing, the opioid crisis, and many other situations. I hope I've represented well, and I look forward to your vote on November 2nd.
Thank you, Mr. Lopez. And we do understand that you need to leave in a few minutes. Mr. Craffey, also Ward 4.
Thank you. Thank you very much. First, I'd like to thank Kim and Gwen and Cassie for the pledge. I'd also like to thank Liz for moderating. Thank you very much. My name is Arthur Craffey. I've been in Nashua since 1991 after the first Gulf War. I moved my family here. The city was great. It was one of the best cities in the country. The educational system was great. I moved them here just for my sons and daughters just for that. All of these were products. All my sons and daughters were products of the national school system. My wife, Joan, who recently passed, was a big supporter of the school system also. She volunteered numerous times at fairgrounds and at Elm Street School. My passion is the city. It is the heart of the city. But it's not just downtown, it's Ward 4. Ward 4 is very unique in that it's divided in two. There is another half of Ward 4 that needs to be represented, and that communication is not there. I want to represent the entire ward. I'm a retired veteran, retired after 25 years plus of serving. been through two wars, and we've seen a lot of changes since the city of Nashua. The city of Nashua has grown tremendously since 1991. It needs fiscal guidance right now. We're on the precipice of a major fiscal crisis. We're spending more money than taxpayers would want to be spent. We need to know where we're going. My experience, I see it, my experience in business for a lot, over 26 years of dealing with budgets and line items and having to know how to deal with a budget and dealing with everything has been my greatest asset. Knowing how to take care of a problem and getting the problem done, getting people to talk to each other and getting solutions solved is what I do. I'm asking for your vote on November 7th. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Craffey. And Ward 5, Mr. Jetty.
I'm Ernie Jetty. I'm running for Ward 5, Alderman. I was born here in Nashua, and I've lived here all of my life, except for the time I went to school. I went to Boston College and got a degree in economics and law there. I spent some time in the Army, and when I was discharged, I had reached the rank of captain. I returned to Nashua and worked as a lawyer for the local legal aid office here for a number of years, and then two friends of mine and I, who I'd grown up with, started a law firm. We eventually merged with Hamblett and Kerrigan and became the largest law firm in the city. I left there and started my own practice, and I maintain an office in Nashua ever since then. I've represented people at all levels, from the district court to the Supreme Court to the U.S. District Court, this First Circuit Court of Appeals. I've been certified by the court system to be a mediator, and I help people resolve their differences. And I think Alderman Lopez would agree that that's an important skill to have with the Board of Aldermen. I've also had a record of public service. I was chairman of the Nashua Regional Planning Commission. I was president of the Nashua Youth Council, the Nashua Rotary Club, the Nashua Bar Association. I was a director of the Nashua Chamber of Commerce and the Greater Nashua Mental Health Center. I've been a volunteer for Corpus Christi Food Pantry and the Soup Kitchen. I was a soccer coach for the Nashua Youth Soccer League, and I was a member of my parish, local church's parish council. I'm running because I want to make sure that Nashua remains a good place for our children and grandchildren to live and work and raise a family. And I ask for your vote on November 7th. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You've had an introduction to all the candidates. We're going to start with our questions. We'll have 1.5 minutes for these questions. And many of you mentioned being longtime residents, being excited about living here in Nashua. In recent years, there's been a lot of interest in the revitalization of the downtown area. Do you think this should be a priority for the city? And if so, what kind of project or projects would you see happening? And Ms. Boris, you're going to go first on this one.
Thank you. I support revitalization downtown, like, as I stated, providing culture and entertainment and opportunities for our residents. We need to support and attract business downtown and our young people back into Nashua. I believe it's very, very important to give a breath of life downtown. We need entertainment. We need something more. We have so many people come into town for dinner, have a cocktail, and that's it. And they're off to Portsmouth or off to Concord. And we really need to be able to capture them. We also need the stream of income downtown.
Thank you. Mr. Gidge.
15 years ago, I sat up here and we did one of these. And we thought there would be profound questions, and it all came down to parking. I want to complain about parking, about those kiosks. I just don't understand why we've got to do all this when the meetings were fun and it was like the old town that we used to live in. As I said, I was the writer and chairman of looking at the economic impact of the arts and culture, and I can tell you right now, having the ability up there to look down at all the state, Nashua is doing really good. So we must stay that way. We must absolutely get something for the artists that was absolutely necessary that did not pass a while back. But also, why don't we try to remember that there are senior citizens who have difficult times coming down here and enjoying themselves. So it's to encumber everyone. And thank you very much. And I'd be it before the stop.
See, don't get too tense about these stop signs, okay? We'll make this work, I promise. Mr. Crafty.
Thank you very much. Sorry, I can take my glass off. I left my reading glasses back home, so. It wasn't as prepared as I thought it was. Revitalization downtown should be community-driven. Government should not be the first step. What happens is, if you rush into it, you become emotionally involved, we end up with a Port Street fiasco. Government should be the last stop. The stop will be, okay, we need to borrow money to hold the building while the community becomes involved. I believe that we need maybe a music comedy venue downtown. Something will draw that age group that we need downtown that has the most expendable income. The 25 to 35, 40-year-old group that comes downtown. They'll spend the money in the village downtown, spend the money downtown at the shops, at the restaurants, at the bars, downtown. Then spend that money afterwards downtown. That's what we need. Government should not be the first stop. Government should always be the last stop. That's putting the cart before the horse. Okay, that's what we should be doing. As far as the Performing Arts Center, yes, we do. We have a Performing Arts Center. It's called the Keith Auditorium. We need to we'll bring it up later on. But with the school construction, expanding the Keith Auditorium to cover that Performing Arts Center. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr.
May I ask Mr. Jaffe to speak up next time, please?
All right. All right, thank you very much. Can you hear me in the back now? Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Jetty, revitalizing downtown.
My office is downtown, so downtown is very important to me. And I think the city's role in downtown is to make sure that it's a safe place, that people can feel comfortable going there. That it be well maintained, that it be a good place to feel an attractive place. So when you look around and you see parking lots that have weeds growing, it seems to me that that would be an easy thing, a cheap thing for the city to spend time on, making sure that everything is well maintained. Let's make sure that what we've got, that we keep well. I also think that I wonder about how people feel about the noise downtown. My wife and I have often, she loves to sit at the outdoor restaurants, but lots of times motorcycles will go by and they reverberate around those buildings and we can't hear each other talk. And I know there are laws on the books and I wonder why they're not enforced more. And I wonder how other people feel about that. As far as the event center, I was disappointed that it did not pass, but now the aldermen have voted to present it to the voters. So all of the voters and all the members of the Ward 5 voters that I'm going to be representing will have a chance to express their opinion about whether they think the event center should go forward. I think it's a great opportunity, but I will abide by however the voters express themselves in the coming election on that issue.
Thank you. And Mr. LeBrun, revitalizing downtown.
Thank you.
Thank you. I also support downtown revitalization. There are many, many empty storefronts downtown, and something has to be done about that. We need jobs to keep our young people here. I support the need for a performing arts venue, not particularly an Alex shoe store. I did not feel, and I voted against that, because I did not feel that it was the proper place for such a venue. Safety. I support the police. I support their efforts to keep the city safe, keep it free of opioids. They're doing a great job. In fact, last night we just approved a grant of $216,000 for them to continue the Granite Hammer issue. Thank you.
Thank you. And your answer has raised a few other questions, so I'd like to give everybody a chance to respond about the Performing Arts Center, which will be a non-binding referendum. If elected, would you support it? Would you vote for it as on the Alderman Board? And if not, what would be some of your criteria for, if you're not sure, what would help you decide? Mr. Gidge, would you start, please, with that?
I'd be glad to. I wanted to just keep out of the whole project. I just wanted to stay away from it. Pass great, fails great. But I did go to one politician and I said, what were you thinking? $19+ million and you couldn't have a room, 2,500 square feet that would have paint, photography, sculptures, from the jewelries, the great things that are taken. How could you do that? How could you build something so large and forget those odds? Now, do we need one? Yes. Is that the place? I'm not sure. But I believe that everyone in here believes if you're going to spend that amount of money, you should at least take the rest of the arts and make sure they have a place. And as a professional artist, it surprises me that no one has said this before. But do we need one? Yes, we do.
Mr. Craffey?
Thank you. Can you hear me back there now? Thank you.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you. I spoke at the Alderman meeting when they voted it down. My concerns were fiscally spending $15.5 million, but that the place at Alex Shoes was not large enough to house it, that there wasn't enough room, that it wasn't going to be fiscally sound to have it there, that it would have another Court Street incident. It wasn't large enough to hold a large enough for the ballet. It wasn't large enough to put a part of the symphony in there. It wasn't large enough to hold any large event that would produce enough money to make it sound, that it would be fiscally sound. And what would happen is that we, as the Board of Aldermen or the government, the City of Nashua, would be bailing it out every year. And it would just be a burden on the taxpayers. And what would happen? How would we get the $15.5 million back? If they're not making any money, how are we getting it back? Therefore, that was my concern. Now, if elected to the board, my ward voted to have it, you know, as binding as it would be, I would vote as the ward voted. I could be against my own personal judgment, but if my ward voted to have it, I would vote according to what the constituents wanted, even though it would be against my own opinion. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Jetty, how would you vote if this passes in November?
Well, I was very disappointed that the Alderman didn't vote for it. You know, we've been talking about this for 15 years. We hired a consultant, a nationally known, experienced consultant team to look at this issue. And they came up with different proposals. And while they were doing this, Alex Shoe Store became available. And they saw this as a golden opportunity for us to have a place right on Main Street that would that would be a great, not only a performing arts center, but an event center. And they recommended, they in their studies and in their experience, they said a larger, 1,000 seat arena would not be feasible, but a 500 to 700 seat arena would be. And that's what they recommended. And they did include the visual arts. Their plan was for the first floor to include a display area for paintings. And it seemed like a golden opportunity because, you know, it's not going to be available forever. And that the Alderman didn't take advantage of that disappointed me. But fortunately, they left it up to the voters. So the proponents and the opponents will have a chance to show why they think it should be done or not be done, and then the voters can decide. And I encourage the voters of Ward 5 to study the issue like I did. I looked at the consultant's report. A lot of the questions that were expressed by the Alderman were answered there. And look at that and make up your own mind. And like I said before, however the voters of Ward 5 vote, it's a non-binding vote, but I will be bound by their vote.
Thank you, Mr. Jetty. Mr. LeBrun, how would you vote if this passes?
If the voters decide in November to promote this venue, I would certainly vote according to the way my constituents tell me to vote. As I said before, I represent my constituents. I talk to my constituents all the time. I know their concerns, and that's the way I conduct myself at the Aldermanic Council. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Boris.
Thank you. I also agree that I was disappointed in the vote at the Aldermanic meeting. Now that it is going to be on the ballot, I hope that Ward 6 comes forth with whatever they decide for our downtown, the Performing Arts Center, and I will support their decision. Thank you.
Thank you. Also in your answers to the first question, some of you mentioned some safety issues, some infrastructure issues. So let's kind of tackle those together in a question. Things such as safe walking within the city, maintenance of the sidewalks, things like that. What do you see as some of the big issues that you would want to address if you were elected? And we're starting with Mr. Craffey.
Thank you. There's a lot that's going to be coming up this year. Sidewalks, paving, those are all big issues for Wardhall. Getting streets paved in the area. You get calls from constituents all the times. When are my streets a mess? When it's going to get done? Sidewalks, there's been an ongoing issue for this city to try to get sidewalks throughout the city. It's been going on for years. Now, when I was an alderman, I always got things done. Crosswalks, safety's always been an issue. I've always been a big proponent of increasing the police force. The city used an index to try to get certain streets paved. So a lot of times people call and say, I need my street paved, I need, we've got potholes. We get potholes filled. As Alderman LeBrun said, you get them filled. But a lot of times the streets can't get paved. Yeah. Right now the mayor wants to borrow $37.5 million on a bond for 20 years to pave streets, which I don't think is a good idea. Because you're going to bond that money for 20 years, but the street's going to have to be repaved in 5 years. All right, so now we've got money that we've got bonded out there. Yes, he's repaying back 24. He's actually, over the next year, he's going to be borrowing almost $173 million in bonded money that's coming up in the next year between Burke Street and the schools. That's another issue which you can bring up later. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Jetty, safety, infrastructure safety.
Well, the if we're still talking about downtown, I think our downtown is very, very attractive and very safe. My office is there. I park in the High Street garage. The city has done quite a bit, I think, to improve things. The garages are well lit. They're well maintained. They're cleaned. And I think, you know, they get a bad rap. I hear a lot of people talk about how they're afraid to use the garages, and I think that's a perception that is not correct. And I think we ought to continue doing what we're doing. I think a police presence downtown. I love the bicycle cops. I think they give a sense of security that. That makes the downtown a very attractive area. And I think the city has been doing a good job under Mayor Donchus. I think they've already adopted this paving plan. They've already voted to borrow the money to do this paving. And you know, we've fallen behind in the past. We didn't keep up the maintenance of our streets as we should have. And now we've fallen behind. And you know, this bond issue, interest rates are as low as they're ever going to be. This is a great time to borrow the money and adopt this paving plan as Mayor Donchus has done with the Board of Aldermen. And I think that's a great step in maintaining our downtown area. And I think that we ought to continue in that vein.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Jetty. Mr. LeBron.
Thank you. I also agree that there are some things that need to be done downtown. For one thing, the parking. As it is right now, if you go to a restaurant, you can hardly get through your dessert before you have to go out and put money in your meter. I think something can be done about that. There's various plans that we have bantered back and forth. But definitely something has to be done about parking. As far as infrastructure goes, yeah, the garage is well lighted, but people still do not feel safe using the garages. I hear it all the time. They do not want to go downtown and park in the garage. They want to park on the street, and that's a problem, as I stated, parking on the street. Safety. If you have a venue like a Performing Arts Center downtown, there's all sorts of things that can take place with that. You have people coming from different areas. The crime can be an issue. You need more police presence. Mr. Jetty mentioned the bicycle police. That's a great idea. That's wonderful. I believe in foot patrolmen. I think we should have foot patrolmen downtown. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Boris?
Thank you. I believe the downtown is looking better than ever. I've heard, I don't hear anyone complaining right now that there is a safety issue. The major concern that I've been hearing is parking. A lot of the small business people, the restaurants, are very concerned that there isn't enough parking, or the parking meters are a problem. They feel that we really do need to make a change or restrict parking, something to revitalize the parking system. We realize it's a stream of income for the city of Nashua, but it's actually not helping our small businesses. Thank you.
And Mr. Gitch?
As I said, 15 years ago, I sat up here, and the main problem was parking. Can we finally take care of it? If there's not enough parking places, why don't we park differently as we did before to get more people down there? I don't want to, it could go on and on. Parking is, for some reason, is very political. Nashua downtown is wonderful. And one of the reasons why it is from a lady who I would say my mentor, Mary Goyette. And when Nashua was looking pretty dim, She got the city to put small, tiny lights all the way down both sides of the street, 365 days a year. And at that particular point, everybody would talk about how warm it was. I like downtown, but for some reason it seems kind of cold. I do design, I understand, the parking garages, if they're safe, they don't feel good. So there's a lot we can do, but why don't we just appreciate what we have?
Thank you, Mr. Gidge. Gwen, do you have some questions for me that your audience questions that you're going to bring up? Oh, we have another one of our student assistants. It delights me here in Nashua that we have students involved in this. Okay. Oh, we did that one. All right. All right, what is your opinion about the restructuring of the city budget, and what is your position on lawsuits to repeal it? How's that for a loaded question? And Mr. Jetty, I'm sorry, you're up first.
Oh boy.
Well, thank you very much. I think what the questioner is asking about is we're talking about, I think, the tax, the spending cap. And, maybe if I could take a minute to try to explain the spending cap. The spending cap is in the city charter, so the aldermen have to abide by that. And the spending cap is based upon last year's budget, or spending budget by the city, the expenditures by the city. And there's, the equivalent, to keep it simple, the consumer price index, it's the gross domestic product deflator for local government. Consumer price index is probably more familiar to people, but it's similar to that. So the budget cannot exceed the consumer price index, or this other name for it, the equivalent, which has been for the past 3 years, the average consumer price index for the past 3 years. So, this is something that, people don't understand, I don't think, that this has nothing to do with your taxes. It's related, but the city is not limited on how much they can, what the tax rate can be, or how much money can be raised by the taxes. They're limited by how much they can spend. And they can only spend a certain percentage above what they spent last year. So it doesn't matter how the tax base increases or decreases, they're limited as to what they spent the last year. So if, for example, Amazon came in.
Your time is almost up, so if you were elected alderman, would you vote to extend or go over the spending cap if the situation were right?
The built into the tax cap, the spending cap, is a safety valve to allow the aldermen to exceed that by 10 votes. If they have 10 votes out of the 15 to exceed it, they can vote to exceed it. And given the right circumstances, yes, I would vote to exceed it. But I would try to abide by the charter as it exists. And abide by the spending cap.
Thank you, Mr. Jetty. Mr. LeBron, you are on the alderman board now. You're an incumbent. So have you been faced with this, of having to consider voting to go over the spending cap?
Yes, we have. Currently, there are some lawsuits against the city pertaining to the spending cap. I'm not going to get into those because they're still active litigation.
Thank you.
I would vote to exceed the spending cap if the conditions were proper. If it was something that I felt that the residents of Nashua, the residents of the state of New Hampshire, would benefit by. You know, it's really theoretical to just sit here and say what we would do in any particular case until that case presents itself. So really, the only thing I can say is I would vote for it in the proper, with the proper venue, but I can't say that I would just vote for it at all times.
Thank you, Mr. LeBrun. Ms. Boris.
Thank you. Actually, this is an active litigation. I would prefer to not give any more of an opinion on it unless I did more research. I don't believe in increasing our taxes or reducing our education or public safety, or eliminating any of that regarding leaving the budget the way it is. I mean, if it was to eliminate the services, I would then make a decision or join on as far as doing an override, but I really do need to do further research on that. Thank you.
Thank you. It is a difficult question. Mr. Ditch.
I was very lucky to be around when this all started. And basically how it started was some concerned people, Fred T. Boone, who I've discussed this with 100 times, and a few other people. And for some reason, how it got in was that people kept saying how bad the aldermen were, how much spending was. It was out of control. And it just went on and on and on. And a lot of people bought that. So the spending cap came in. But as time goes on, and the aldermen are pulling as far as they can in on monies, sometimes to keep the police, the fire, the teachers, and everything kind of moving, maybe it's time we should not stop the spending cap. Maybe it's time to tweak it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Crappie.
Thank you. This is a tough issue. And I'm going to take the same position as Mr. LeBrun. It's an active issue, and I'm not going to comment. Given the certain circumstances, I would override the cap on certain circumstances, but it would have to be presented correctly. Thank you.
All right, thank you. We're going to change the pace a little bit. These are going to be short answer questions, yes, no, or one sentence. That's it. Okay?
You're asking politicians to do a one answer question?
I know. This is hard. This is hard, people. I realize this. Now, the library is co-sponsoring this program. So the questions from the library is, first, what's the title of the last book you read? Mr. Crappie, we'll go down the row. Last book you read, Mr. Crappie.
Tom Clancy's Out of the Ashes.
Mr. Jetty.
It was John Grisham's Whistler.
I haven't gotten to that one yet. It's on my list. Mr. LeBrun.
Wow. I cannot remember the last book I read, and I've just read it this past week. I've got to be honest with you, I cannot remember.
But it was good, right?
It was excellent.
Okay. Ms. Boris?
That was a great question. I've actually been reading Socrates. I'm actually of Greek descent, and I just picked that book up in Europe, and I began, but I have a long way to go.
Mr. Gidge?
A lot of people think I don't read, and some of them are correct. But since I work on art, I listen to books. And I, in the last 4 months, I have re-listened to 27 books by John Stewart, which I love the mysteries. And there's 15 books that I'm look at and go into. But Audible has really been nice to me, and I consider that reading. And then when I do have the opportunity, it's nice to hold a book.
Okay, and that was one of the other library questions, that if you get books from the library or from Amazon or whatever, do you get paper books, do you get e-books, or do you get audio books? So we've heard Mr. Gidge's answer. Ms. Boris, what do you prefer?
Paper books.
Mr. LeBrun?
Hardbacks.
Mr. Jetty?
The John Grisham book was a hardbound book that I bought for my father-in-law, and after he finished reading it, I read it. But I'm looking at my wife, and I remember now, we just listened to A Girl on a Train, and that was an audible.
Okay. And Mr. Crafty, paper, audio, e-book?
I do e-book and audible, and also paper.
Okay, all right. Well, they read. This is good. All right. Another lightning round question. Is social media an effective way to communicate with constituents? And if elected, will you be tweeting from the will you be tweeting from the aldermanic chamber? Oh, let's start with Mr. Jetty on this one.
I'm not a tweeter.
Okay.
I'm a Facebook voyeur, so I look at Facebook and I keep track of what my friends are doing, and my wife has helped me with a Facebook page, Ernie Jetty for Ward 5 Alderman.
Shameless plugging. Thank you. Mr. LeBrun, would you use social media?
Oh boy, I love the answer to this question. People tell me all the time, I saw what you posted on Facebook. I saw your picture on Facebook. I'd like you to know I have never, ever been on Facebook and never intend to go on Facebook. So how much honesty could there be on Facebook when people post in your name?
That is an issue. You're right. You wouldn't tweet either, apparently.
I do not tweet and do not intend to.
There we go. Ms. Boris?
Thank you. I do use Facebook quite a bit. I do not tweet.
Okay. Mr. Gidge?
Great opportunity to advertise my Go to Gidge World, and you can see my. Really? I understand that I really want to talk to people. I really want to hear a voice. Sometimes it is absolutely necessary to do it. I understand very few times people get something from me, not get something from me, but when they give me something, I will return. But talking should get back in style.
Okay, Mr. Crafty.
I do have a Facebook account. Whether or not I use it, I use it to keep in touch with my cousins, all 400 of them. Yeah, I come from a large family. I don't tweet. I use email a lot, so.
All right, we've got a variety of answers here. This was fascinating. Here's another quickie question. Surf or MT's local? Starting with Mr. LeBrun.
I'm sorry, could you repeat that?
If you're going out for a meal, do you go to Surf or MT's Local?
Surf.
Okay. Ms. Boris?
Surf.
Mr. Gidge?
I need an interpretation.
I understand they're across the street. I don't live in Nashua, people. I understand they're across the street from each other, owned by the same person.
So yes, I know that.
Okay.
I like fish, mostly.
Okay. Mr. Crafty?
Surf.
Mr. Jetty?
We do the buck-a-shuck at Surf, but we prefer MTs.
All right. So, again, we've got a nice variety. All right. Would you like to see new businesses in Nashua? And if so, which kind? Quick answer. Maybe more than a sentence, but quick answer. Who am I up to starting with? Ms. Boris, I think? Go ahead.
That's a tough one. I do want new businesses downtown. Maybe a nice Greek restaurant?
That would be good. Okay. Greek restaurants are always good. Mr. Gidge?
I don't think there's anything called an English restaurant. This is a great town, but guess what? You still can drive downtown if we think it's so great and there are empty stores. We've got to do something. I don't know what or who is trying to get businesses in here, but I think at this particular point, something that would work with everything around it, and that would be the only answer I would have, something that would fit.
Okay. Mr. Crafty?
I would like to see something of a magnet, something to draw people downtown. I don't care what type of business it is, something that would draw people from around to downtown. Once downtown, they could enjoy our shops and other food, bars, and entertainment downtown.
Okay, Mr. Jetty.
Well, downtown isn't just Main Street. It's the streets parallel to it and perpendicular to it. You know, there have been great things happening at 30 Temple Street. Some great new high-tech industries have moved in there. There's some high-tech industries in the mill yard that have moved in. Those are the kinds of things that I think are great for attracting jobs for people downtown. There's been great development for housing. Main Street itself probably needs more retail. And the merchants themselves downtown have told us that the event center would be a great magnet that they would love to see downtown.
Mr. LeBron, what businesses would you like to see downtown?
As a member of the parish council of the Greek Orthodox Church on exit 5, I too, and I am a Frenchman, but I am a parish council member of the Greek Orthodox Church. I too would like to see a nice Greek restaurant, a high-end Greek restaurant.
Raise your hand, people. Would you like to see a Greek restaurant downtown? Look at this. Two of the
Thank you.
All right, thank you. Just the other day, maybe it was yesterday, I saw in the news that Mayor Donchus is going to propose a partnership between the city and a private railroad company in order to offer a commuter rail service. It's not something that would happen overnight. It would be expected to run from Lowell to Nashua and then to Bedford. Eventually it would operate on a for-profit basis. If this comes before you, if you are elected, how would you vote for this proposed public-private partnership for rail service? And I'll go back to my ordered structure here, and Mr. LeBrun, you're up first.
At the State House, when this issue came up, I voted for it. I supported the mayor and the city of Nashua, because that's what my people wanted me to do. The current issue of the partnership, unless we can bring people in from both sides of the state into Nashua, where they can catch the train into Boston, I'm a little bit skeptical as to how well it can work. There are people in all parts of our state, and if we want the rail to be successful, we've got to find a way to bring those people to Nashua conveniently so that they can catch the train, because the train will only go to Lowell, and then you will have to change trains to go into Boston. So I would vote for it.
Thank you. Ms. Boris, would you support it?
Thank you. Yes, I fully support the commuter rail.
Thank you. Mr. Gidge, would you support it?
Absolutely. And I was there when someone made the first speech against it. I know we don't have time to talk about that. But one must start to invest And a railroad is an investment. We'd like it to pay also.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Crafty?
Yes, I would definitely support. I've been a big proponent of commuter rail for a long time. Not only does it allow us to go there, but it also brings people here to use our shopping malls, to use our shores. Another way of bringing people downtown, to use downtown Nashua. It also brings workers that work in Massachusetts to here, bring families here. The big thing about Nashua now, we have full-day kindergarten, which has been a stumbling block for businesses to come to Nashua because we did not have a full-day kindergarten, which a lot of businesses have been sort of hemming and hawing about coming to working in Nashua, setting up businesses. We now have that, which allows those businesses to come here, brings families. Families buy houses. Families buy homes. They increase the tax base. Therefore, I am a big, big proponent of rail, just for that reason. It brings people here, set up shop. You know, we can build all the apartments we want downtown, but those people aren't taxpayers. All right, we want taxpayers here. Eventually, if we can work with the MBTA, which I believe Boston, Massachusetts does want to happen, they eventually want to relieve, to build the rail, not only to Nashville, but eventually get it to Concord. Allows us to relieve traffic going into Logan. All right, get the road, get rid of the road traffic going into Logan. Therefore, it helps get the traffic off the road. Therefore, I'd definitely support the commuter rail.
All right, thank you. And Mr. Jetty, would you support the rail public-private partnership?
Yes, I've been a long-time fan of bringing the railroad service back to Nashua, but it comes with a price, and we've heard for so long about how the railroad, like every transportation system, whether you're talking about railroad, airports, air transportation, the roads that we use now with our cars and trucks and everything, are all subsidized by the government. Now this comes out of the blue, some private company that says that they will pay for everything, and that it will be of no cost to the city, and they think that they can develop do it at a profit. This seems too good to be true, but certainly I would, the aldermen have already voted to allocate money to do a further study about the possibility of bringing rail just to Nashua, and I certainly would, I think we need to do due diligence with this this Boston Surface Railroad. But if they're legitimate, it sounds like a dream come true.
Thank you. And as we talk about rail, we're also perhaps wondering, and some of you have mentioned it, other modes of transportation. I don't think you want Nashua to get more and more cars all the time. So do you see other transportation needs in the city that the Board of Aldermen should consider supporting? And we're starting with Ms. Boris.
Thank you. I believe all our transportation needs to be updated, and our buses, whatever we have in the city of Nashua should be safe and accessible to all our citizens. Thank you.
Mr. Gidge?
I think that's a very interesting question. Did you mean other types of transportations than cars? We know that a lot of cities are putting bikes in where you can rent them.
That's one.
Small automobiles, sometimes even scooters. If that's what we're talking about, the answer is yes.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Crafty?
Thank you. Actually, Mr. Gidd brought up a good point. Bike rental stations would be good. Bike paths would be nice. Bike space on the main street would be actually a thing where people would actually ride their bikes without being hit by cars going by would be excellent. I definitely would sponsor legislation like that. The current bus system is, I ride it all the time. I would definitely like to see it go greener with natural gas. We have a natural gas station right here in Nashua. It's one of the few in the state that we have. I was on the board when we sponsored that legislation, built that. I'm looking at, I'd like to see Sunday service for the buses. Something that would be really, really interesting. It would help the workforce. It would help the merchants, actually. It would be bringing people downtown. Bring people to the malls. It'd be actually help people. I use the bus service a lot myself, rather than drive my car around. Makes it nice and easy. Portable bikes. Millennials do this thing called share a ride. When they get cars, I have no. My son was trying to explain it to me. I had no clue what he's talking about. So I have no idea what the thing. But it's something that could be looked into. Rent a car for a day. Things like that. Things I think worth exploring as alternative means to transportation or something to be worth looking into. Thank you.
Okay, we're getting some good ideas here. Mr. Jetty, any ideas from you?
I think one of the things that makes a city attractive is the ease of being able to move around in the city. And the worse that our traffic becomes, and we live in Ward 5. We see West Holler Street, which is one of the main roads, and Main Dunstable Road, becoming more and more clogged with traffic at certain times of the day. I'm not sure what can be done about that, but providing alternate means of transportation other than the private automobile is a step in the right direction. I'm a cyclist. I think making the roads more bicycle-friendly would be a great thing. You know, as the city paves roads and remarks the lanes, if they could incorporate that as part of the transportation plan, I think that would be a great idea. Improving and expanding the bus system would be a good system, and tying it into this new railroad that hopefully we'll get. Anything to lessen the use of the private automobile would be a step in the right direction.
Thank you. Mr. LeBrun, any ideas that you have for alternative transportation?
Yes, definitely accommodating bicycles more in the outer areas of Nashua as well as downtown. Also, I'll say it tongue-in-cheek. When we get driverless cars, maybe we can have those pick people up and drop them off, and we won't have a parking problem.
It's all right. We need driverless cars with audiobooks in them, right?
And expand the bus service.
Okay. Thank you. On a more serious note, one of the people in the audience said, with the teacher's contract going back into negotiations, what would you do to support the teachers to obtain a fair contract? And we're starting with Mr. Gidge on this one.
My wife was a teacher for 20 years. There's enormous things taking place. Public education is under attack, and people understand. Maybe you don't feel it's good, maybe you need something different, but let's try to get our public education back. And every time people mention teachers, it's like, oh, it's going to cost a lot of money, forgetting that teachers, you know, help. I haven't found any teachers that were terrible, but you mention them, and it's like, they're terrible people. And, you know, when you talk about teachers or police or firemen or anything like that, you forget that there are one, two, three, they're personal. I think we have to stop it. Teachers must be treated properly. And if it happens to be financially, yes. If it happens not to be financially, no. But let's try to treat our teachers with a little respect as our firemen, as our police.
Mr. Craffey, what would you do to help the teachers get a fair contract?
The contract they reached was equitable for both sides. Going back into negotiations because there were some disagreements within the teachers union on the contract. It was a very close vote. I'd be interested to see what comes out of it, but I would support the teachers' contract. I'm a firm believer in the teachers, supported the teachers all when I was on the board before, support the teachers now. They are the backbone of our student education. They should be paid fairly and equitably. Tongue-tied moment. Edit that out, please. And I strongly believe they should be paid that way. I haven't worked as a substitute teacher in the system. I understand at one point when I was unemployed, I understand the problems they face firsthand. It's not an easy job. Your hands are tied. The hours are long. And the amount of time they put into the job is amazing, and the dedication is amazing. There's no such thing as a bad teacher. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jetty. How would you help the teachers get a fair contract?
To keep Nashua a good place to live, work, and raise a family, we need to invest in our public school system. And the biggest investment, the biggest part of that public school system are the teachers. So I fully support the teachers in making sure that they are treated fairly, that they are treated with respect, that they are given not only the pay that they deserve, but the support, the financial support, you know, books, equipment, all the other things. I hear teachers having to take money out of their own pockets in order to provide their students with what they need to learn. You're not going to attract good paying jobs and employers that are willing to pay and attract people here if you don't have a good school system. One of the problems we have is our unemployment rate is very low. One of the problems we have are attracting workers, a good workforce to fill those jobs. And that good workforce comes from attracting people here, yes, but also training our own people, training our students to be able to be qualified to take those jobs and to stay here as opposed to having to go elsewhere to find good paying jobs.
Thank you. Mr. LeBrun, what would you do to help the teachers get a fair contract?
Obviously, The teachers and education are the backbone of our society. I don't think anybody disputes that. I don't know what it was that kept the teachers from ratifying the contract that was presented to them. I don't know all the issues that they were disappointed in. I would have voted for that contract had it come before the Aldermanic Council. I don't know what the next contract is going to be, whatever they ratify and whatever they send to us. But I support the teachers. I support education. Like I said, it's the backbone of our society. If we don't have decent education, we do not have a progressive society that will enhance everything as we go along. Thank you.
And Ms. Boris.
Thank you. I fully support the teacher's contract. I believe that teachers should feel their security and not every year have uncertainty of their compensation or if they're going to have everything that they need to properly teach our students. I believe our education is a very, very strong and necessary for our children from kindergarten up. And whatever possibly we can do to support them, that they're properly compensated, I would stand by them 100%. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Since we brought up the topic of school, of course, we now have in Nashua and many other places full-day kindergarten with more money to come to the districts if towns actually allow Keno. And I'm a little bit confused by the notes. I'm not sure it's definite that it's going to be on your ballot this year. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. So the question is, do you think Keno is a good thing for Nashua? We probably agree that all-day kindergarten is, and getting more money is a good thing, but is Keno itself a good thing? Mr. Crappie, you're up.
Thank you very much. I'm sort of mixed about this. I think it needs to be studied more carefully as far as national goes, especially in my ward. I contain the inner city. Studies have shown the impact of gambling on the inner cities has increased addiction to gambling for the poor, the poorest neighborhoods. And my ward contains that. This is a very, very, as a concerned citizen, I'm concerned about this. As an alderman, I'd even show a greater concern. Another concern I have is Nashua sends more money up to the state than any other major cities, and yet we get a lesser return. My question would be, and we have representatives here that we can ask them, would the same equitable share come back? Yes, we're getting all-day kindergarten. We send more money up, do we get it back? That's the question, all right? Does it apply, would it apply to education revenue? That's my question. I'm not going to put them on the spot and ask them right now because that's putting them on the spot, and I don't want to put them on the spot. I don't want to do that to them tonight. But whenever we send money up, for every dollar we send up, we don't get it all back. And Manchester does, other cities in the county do. Those are questions that we have to ask. Thank you for waving your hands and saying speak up. All right? I got a coach right there. So those are the concerns I have. Keno is a good idea to raise educational money, but everywhere that's shown that in the poor neighborhoods, not only here in Nashua, but other poor neighborhoods across poor inner cities, we have to worry about gambling addiction. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Mr. Jetty, what's your view of Keno in Nashua?
Well, I think that full-day kindergarten is a great thing, and I'm glad that the city of Nashua voted to establish it. Separately, the legislature provided for full-day kindergarten, but unfortunately, they tied it to Keno. And I think that is not the right way to support education. I think the state is continuing to punt their responsibility. The responsibility of education is a state responsibility, and they keep pushing it off. Instead of the state raising the money to support and pay for education, they put it onto the cities and towns to do it through the local property tax. And now they've come up with this Keno idea. It's not going to be in our hands. It's going to be up to the voters. The alderman took advantage of the state law, which allows the cities to provide the voters of the city to adopt the Keno or not. So the voters of Nashua will be voting whether or not Nashua will authorize a Keno in the city of Nashua. Interestingly, whether or not Nashua votes to adopt Keno has nothing to do with whether Nashua will get money from the state. The law provides, it costs, I think, $3,600 per student. That's what the state says. They're going to give us, no matter whether we adopt Keno or not, they're going to give everybody that has full-day kindergarten $1,100 per student. And as Keno goes on, if it makes money, they'll increase it to $1,800, which is half of the cost. So the city of Nashua is still going to be responsible for most of the cost of providing full-day kindergarten, and which I think we should do, but I think the state should be paying for education as provided in the Constitution.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Jetty. And you make a good point that whether Nashua votes to have Keno or not, the law is in place, and wherever Keno is held, that money is pooled and then given out to all the towns that have full-day kindergarten. So the question is, rather, do you feel that Nashua should move forward with having Keno? Mr. LeBrun, you voted on this in Concord, didn't you? But you don't have to tell us how you voted.
Oh, I'm not afraid to tell you how
okay.
I voted. I'm transparent, believe me. I voted against this bill. Why did I vote against it? Because it was a backroom deal. It was a deal the governor made with the Speaker of the House and the Senate President to marry Keno to all-day kindergarten in order to get the votes from both sides to pass it. I'm a big proponent of all-day kindergarten, but not if Keno has to support it. And the reason is, we once had the tobacco settlement. That was supposed to, a certain amount of money was supposed to go to education. That has been reduced time and time again. We had the Liquor Commission. Money was supposed to go to education from, or addiction problems with alcohol. That money has been reduced. The same thing will happen with this. The state will continually reduce the amount they send to the city. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Boris?
Thank you. I fully support full-time kindergarten. I feel in regards to the Keno and gambling, I don't agree how they should be tied in together. At this point, it's going to be on the ballot, and whatever the voters decide in Ward 6, I'll stand by them. But again, I don't fully understand how they're tying the Keno slash gambling with kindergarten at all. Thank you.
It's an odd marriage, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Mr. Gibbs.
You know, I like to try to be lighthearted, but this came into our committee, and a group of us got together and we said, okay, what's going to be in 20 years? Look, they're building a big casino away from us, not far. They estimate that 20% of the parking, the plates, will be from New Hampshire. Millions of dollars are going to go from here to there. We also know that some of our stores down on the mall are potentially our anchor stores may be leaving for all sorts of reasons. One is obviously buying things over the net. But the main thing is the politicians in Massachusetts are so mad at New Hampshire for being tax-free. So, if you look at all the money New Hampshire is going to spend that way to the casinos, and they bring down their taxes like down to 4 cents, we are in big trouble. So Keno is something very small. You gotta look at things, and this is really truthfully something that we've gotta do, because I warn people, if you don't get your hand around or your head around this, and I'm not just talking myself, a lot of people, we're in big, big trouble because we can't make this up.
Thank you.
Is it for or against it? I really don't get from what you said.
Your answer. Yeah, I think he's given the answer. Okay. From an economic perspective, I'm changing tactics here, okay? New topic. From an economic perspective, do you see immigration as helping or hindering business and economic growth in Nashua? And Mr. Jetty, you're up first.
I think that immigration is helping business. I think it has for years, I think most of us, probably all of us in this room, our parents immigrated here at one point. Certainly my grandparents immigrated here from Canada. They came down to, they left the farms of Quebec started working in the mills here. They were looking for better opportunities, and the mills needed workers. I think our immigrants not only are filling jobs here, the employers tell us that that if it weren't for the immigrants, they wouldn't be able to stay in business. And it's not only low-paying jobs. A lot of our immigrants are successful entrepreneurs. They're CEOs. There are people that I meet in the Rotary Club who are from elsewhere and who have come here and started businesses. I think immigration has been the heart and soul of this country forever and continues to be so. And without it, I do not think that we can continue to thrive.
Excuse me, thank you. Mr. LeBrun, immigration helping or hurting business and in Nashua?
I think for the most part, immigration has helped business and helped the economy of Nashua. Most of your businesses that you go into are either owned or operated by immigrants. I can't think of any offhand that I go into that there aren't immigrants either owning or operating the business. So I think they definitely help the economy.
We just need some Greeks to open that restaurant.
Greeks are immigrants too?
Yeah. Ms. Boris?
Yes, I believe that the immigrants have definitely helped. They're hardworking. A lot of them have their own shops. They work excessive hours, and I think that it's a positive impact on us. And I need to make one statement regarding the Greek restaurants, that we do have a friend on Main Street that has the Gyro, who's excellent, excellent food, and great, great people, and no disrespect to them at all in regarding doing a Greek restaurant. Thank you.
But Gyro's already high end.
We just want a few more, it sounds like. Okay, Mr. Gidge?
If she bribes you with a Greek restaurant and you vote for her and we're competitors, I'm gonna be mad. Of course, my father, as I said, was born St. Joe's Hospital. I mean, immigrants. French from my mother, Italian. I mean, what's really disgusting is what's taking place. Not here, but in Washington, from people talking about immigrants. That hurts people who are here who wish to stay. But are immigrants important? Of course. This is America.
Thank you. Mr.
Traffy,
we'll end with that one.
End with me, huh? Okay. We have a little family joke that for my parents, my mom said, you know, they came over on the Mayflower, and my dad said he came over on the bottom of the boat. So, anyways, immigrants are very, very important. They are the backbone of the workforce here in Nashua and elsewhere. I think they're very helpful for the businesses in Nashua and in the area. Thank you.
All right, thank you. And I think we're going to take our closing statement. Now, I hope you didn't script anything, people, because we're giving you 1 minute to say something that you haven't had a chance to say this evening, something we didn't ask you about that you would like to share with the audience. And by drawing cards earlier, Mr. Jetty is going first.
Well, I'm running because I love Nashua. I think Nashua is a great place. You know, I'm constantly amazed by how many people I meet who aren't from Nashua, who came from somewhere else, but chose Nashua to be their home. And I see Nashua highly rated by national magazines. I think Mayor Donchus has done a great job in his first term as mayor, and he's doing a great job now, making Nashua a good place to live, to work, and to raise a family in. And I want to make sure that that continues. My family is from Nashua. My daughter and my grandson still live here. And I want to make sure that Nashua remains a good place to live, work, and raise a family for them and for all of our children and grandchildren. And I appreciate your vote on November 7th.
Thank you. Mr. LeBrun, closing statement.
Thank you. Some of the things that I have not mentioned before, obviously I want to serve my constituents and I'm asking for your vote. I am a veteran. I served 4.5 years in the Korean theater. I started out in life homeless. I was homeless until I was 17 years old. At that time, I went into the military because that's where I could get clothes on my back and I could get meals. I love serving people. I love my constituents. I work hard for my constituents. I'm told I live a very boring life because I eat, sleep, politics all the time. That's all I do. But I enjoy every minute of it. And I enjoy helping people. I have gotten streets paved, as I said before. I've gotten potholes fixed. I have gotten signage in Nashua Ward 5. I work for my people. When they call me, I respond. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. LeBrun. Ms. Boris.
As your alderman, I will be accessible. I would listen to all of your needs and do my best to be a voice in Nashua. Like I said, I run a business, a mortgage company downtown Nashua, where I make dreams of homeownership a reality. I love helping people. I love giving back to my community. It's the most fulfilling thing that I can do. So I ask for your support and your vote on November 7th. And I thank you for your time.
Mr. Ditch.
It's hard to say anything bad about my opponent other than she's trying to bribe you with a Greek restaurant. She's absolutely great. If you didn't elect me and you elected my opponent, I'm sure Ward 6 would be just fine. The difference between us is spending all our time in Concord and Commerce Committee and having this particular type of knowledge, not just that as knowledge, but in the arts, living in the city, looking, wanting to make things not bigger, better. But again, good luck to both of us. One other thing. Thank you very much. Telegraph, thank you very much. Who else? Access TV and a library.
Yes.
Thanks.
Yes, thank you. And Mr. Crafting.
Can I get the final word?
You do.
Oh my God. No,
1 minute.
1 minute. 1 minute. 1 minute.
Okay.
1 minute. All right. Start the timer now. Don't talk. Okay. Thank you, Liz, for doing this. This is great. Thanks to League of Women Voters. Thank you. All the conversation tonight has seemed to have been on downtown. I want to talk to the taxpayer. We've got a very, very, very fiscal crisis looming over the next couple of years. There's a lot going on that's going to be coming up. We've got Elm Street School that needs to be addressed. It either has to be renovated, which will be more problems, or torn down and rebuilt. We have the Burke Street project, which is coming up, which needs to be redone. It has to be done. We've got other projects the mayor wants that needs to be done. It's a lot of bonding. There has to be some tough choices in the next few years. This is what your taxes are going for. You need someone that's going to be able to make tough choices. That's me. I've done it before. When I was on the board before, we had low tax rates. But now it's time to go. And I see the stop sign come up, so I guess I'm going to say, vote for me on November 7th. Have a great night, and thank you very much for coming out.
Okay, and again, and the League of Women Voters thanks the Nashua Telegraph for co-sponsoring this, the library for hosting us. I thank all the members of the League who worked so hard to make this happen and the young people who participated. But especially we have to thank our candidates for running, for their thoughtful answers. So please, I lift my banner. I will remind you that Access Nashua, the cable TV station, has been taping this. It will be posted on their website and will be on channel 96 within a day or two. And I remind you that we have four other forums scheduled. So the next one, October 19th, is for the Alderman at Large race. I'll be back, I'll see you then again. And then we have wards 7 through 9 on October 25th, the Board of Education on October 26th, and then wards 1 through 3 on November 1st. So tell your friends, tell your neighbors. If they miss this, encourage them to watch it on TV and tell your friends in other parts of the city to come to their races. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you.